Hi there, and welcome back to Pillars of Eternity 2 Deadfire. We are stranded, and we are now at the Euthasian dig site. And we want to find the head researcher's corpse, or what is left of the head researcher, what he has maybe become in here, as a magical storm has destroyed nearly everything. We are going to be dungeon crawling. We're going to explore some rooms, slay some monsters, and hunt some treasures. That's what I expect, but of course it will be conversations now. Now that I've said it. Look at that, there's a will-o'-wisp in the room. Maybe let's go this way then. We've recently gotten Aloth as a companion. Our new wizard that you might know in Pillars of Eternity 1. Will-o'-wisp is coming, and everyone needs to attack. Yeah, it's just one opponent. I expect it to be an easy encounter, so I'm not going for some deep tactics. We'll just hit it and bring it down that way. There we go.
Keeping an eye out.
Let's see what we can find here.
Of course.
In the deep darkness. I think we've come in here, haven't we? No. We've come in this way, in the menagerie. Probably here. These shadows. Oh, that was the entry hall, yes. Okay. So it seems the magical storm also had an effect underground. The people there have also become ashen statues. This looks like there could be some slimes waiting for us. That's the laboratory. Oh! Essence anomalies. What's that? They probably feel us. A greater anomaly? That is not good at all. Adair, save us. Maybe you can block, right? Yeah, you go to the greater anomaly. And Aloth, what can you do? What should you do? Necrotic Lance could be good. Let's find out. Yeah, the Fortitude is the lowest save they have. So that could be a good thing. But we need to position ourselves first. Let's order Aloth here. We're going to be moving slightly forward. And Kshoti. Pillar of Faith should be good too. Let's wait until they come. Oh, that one is moving around this way, okay. Now we've got it. Kevava can also start. Taking probably this anomaly. I don't know if we can cripple them or something. But we'll certainly try. We can go for combusting wounds. Causes enemy wounds in the area of effect to ignite, inflicting additional burn damage over time, each time they receive damage. And this is probably a good thing, but I'm not sure. Maybe the other anomaly is coming as well. And then, yeah, we'll wait until it is there. It's hobbled even, an anomaly. Well, an anomaly can be anything, everything. So it can, of course, also be hobbled, right? Let's try the lance. Let's maybe run here first. You can go for the Pillar of Faith. Necrotic Lance. Suffer. Okay, we're grazing them only. Yeah, we need to try everything at the start already to get these down. That one is in danger. We can flank it now. We should do that too. Essence Anomaly. Greater Anomaly as well. In danger. Mind you, this is part of the Damned. So are we damned already? Not sure. The Holy Power would reach no one. Blessed Harvest is also against Strength. We should try that. Aloth can go for Fan of Flames. Yeah, let's actually try that. Bring them down. It's not the best, but could be good. Oh, there we go. Look at that. Xoti has killed the anomaly. Flank the greater one. Let's maybe wait until we flank the greater one. Yeah, that's better. Now let's flank it. Actually, let's attack the normal essence anomaly and move Kebaba this way. Hey, where are you going? Xoti? Oh my god. Where's this going? Come on. Oh, Aloth, okay. We need to flank that thing. Make it a lot easier to deal with it. What do we have here? The Blessed Harvest. Yes, let's do that. And I don't know, just attack, I guess. Aloth as well. The Minoletta's missiles will be good. Ah, nice. Nice going. Flanking that thing as well. The anomaly is bloodied. Pretty cool. No prisoner. Adair, yes. Please. Never you mind that mess. Ha ha ha. Are we good or what? These anomalies have nothing on us. Our shadows are more mighty than they are. Oh, actually, this was pretty creepy. Who knows? That's just a random encounter, not a tough one, probably. And it has cost us like everything we had. We need to become better. Well, on the other hand, we didn't even get a wound, so that's also like a good sign. There's something coming from the top here, as if the whole building was about to come down. Whoa. Brine Imp. Immunity ground and mind, what is that? It's getting crazier. It's getting crazier. that thing doing? Yeah, kill them all. We'll have Adair come for the imp. What is he doing? He's casting something. Shoti. Should get this weakness to something like that. Reap the enemy and Aloth. What do you have? Bolts of electricity. I don't know. Combusting wounds. We can try that. Actually, Xioti was very, very good at that. Have you seen that? The brine imp just going down, and now we've got gunpowder here. Interesting, interesting.
Let's take a look.
Is that wine here or something? Is that where they had the special stuff? There's Orland's Cradle, named by Red Cairn settlers. Oh, that's mushrooms. Who came upon the mushrooms in the forest? This thick, flat fungus grows along the base of large trees. Hey, come on. Is that speciesist? Are Orland's really so small? Well, yes, we know. We had an Orland baby with us growing up, probably. What's that? What are these people here doing? Let's have a look. They're bringing something, or they're around that. That could be a throne, or it could be some kind of flame. It looks like a piece from a chessboard, a rook. It could be a rook. These fanatical chess players in the deep, dark dungeons. And they have a rook that has a magical flame. Let's look at it. This moss and grime have been scraped clear of large portions of this mural, revealing the vibrant hues of the Ingwithan figures beneath. Well, the Ingwithans were certainly an enigmatic folk, so who knows? Maybe they worshipped chess figures, chess pieces. What is that? There's a journal entry. Oh, I love that. And an animancer's head. Cool. It has been a stroke of unimaginable fortune to find an Adravain in such pristine condition. The essence is so concentrated here that, even from the far side of the corridor, the pillar's light pulses like a star. At times I almost feel as if I can sense it, like the warmth of sunlight upon the skin. We will need to reinforce the central chamber before attempting further excavations. The ruins are unstable, and Sela's motley workforce of savages and paupers grows more fearful by the day. With the assistance of a single watcher, we could trace the essence in the primary vein and isolate those deposits worthy of extraction. I've petitioned Director Castall in Nicotaka for such a resource, but I'm continually rebuffed. It's unthinkable that the Valiant Trading Company cannot isolate within the vast borders of its considerable influence a single suitable candidate. I must assume that the wretched Elet woman is hoarding them for her fanciful experiments. Transportation. As if we have the time to expend on such frivolities. Interesting. So watchers are sought also because of other things. Not so. And what is that shield? That looks like the gong from these old films from MGM or something. Doro the Reckless defeated 7 beasts barehanded. Oh, that reminds me of a good metal singer from Germany. She's also called Doro, just as it's written here. So, the machine and its sparks. Doro could write the one of the soundtracks for a game like this, probably. I'm pretty sure. Along the lines of Blind Guardian, singing of old tales, forgotten kingdoms, haunted by the dead now. Copper cables again. I hear static. There's a pillar. Incoming, says the map. Ooh, that was an influential figure, I guess. All right. First, let's have a look at the surroundings. Not touch him. Because can you see that? There's lightning going here. Odorisi. Let's find him. Frozen mid-stride, this grim figure is turned toward the colossal pillar of Ardra that dominates the chamber. The ashen corpse's outstretched hand rests upon the crystal's dull surface. Clutched tightly in the remnants of a fist is a bundle of papers bound together by a leather cord. Several more pages are scattered on the ground at your feet.
This one's ashen. Means he ain't got no soul for me to tend to, right?
As you pull the papers free, the ashen fingers gripping them slough away, disintegrating into a fine plume of dust. We've gained the Odorisi's notes. A dense collection of jargon and diagrams. They allude to mechanical and chemical processes used to treat Ardra while it is refined into powder. These notes would doubtless be of interest to those working directly with the luminous Ardra. Standing here by the lone figure, you're struck with a feeling of dread. The air around you, the very motes of ash and dust, all of it is stagnant and still. The feeling grows worse when you look up at the Ardra and sense no energy flowing into its surface. It is as though it has been disconnected from the wheel.
Place your hand against the pillar of luminous Ardra. A dim, warm light emanates from the surface, but it feels cool to the touch. Pinpricks dance along your fingers, uncomfortable, but not painful. A woman's voice, scratchy, distant, and halting, echoes in your mind.
Find your soul in him.
You concentrate, peering into the Ardra's energy as you would peer into a soul. Its inner light is blinding, but as you become accustomed to it, you perceive the core of the Ardra itself, a churning mass of millions of soul fragments. With a jolt, the energy reaches out to you, the Angwithin ruin fragments around you, breaking into incoherent shapes and dissolving to dust. Falling into an infinite well of dark gray vapor. Even the ground itself disintegrates into nothingness. All that remains is the murky expanse of the in-between. The Ardra pillar, and a skein of golden threads rooted in the pillar that extend far off into the distance. You focus on the threads. You catch glimpses of memories, your memories, mingled among the memories of thousands of other captive souls. The filaments begin to cohere, rapidly twining into a golden cord. With a muffled crack, the cord ripples outward in a violent wave toward the endless distance. The cord undulates over a space so vast that you lose sight of the wave before it finds its end. Then, a heavy creaking, like the sound of mountains shearing under their own weight, washes through the dull gloom of the in-between. A violent force yanks you along the cord at an incredible speed. The murk of the in-between warps erratically, as though you are observing it through an ill-ground lens. Just as quickly as you were pulled forward, you stop, suspended below a massive figure of ancient carved Ardra. Like all Ardra, it glimmers with energy, but the souls and memories within it are not flowing down. They churn in a vortex that burns at the heart of the statue's mass in some invisible engine. It is Aethys. The great golden cord terminates in his back, sending pulses of energy throughout his limbs as they move. He walks in long, slow strides toward a brilliant pillar of Audra far in the distance. It shines even more brightly in the in-between than Aethys. From within the teeming throng of souls, dozens of eyes look out to you. Through the cord, their collective anguish and despair push at the edge of your mind.
Help us! Please! Help us!
Their voices echo in your mind. Somewhere within their ranks, you can feel the presence of your own soul slumbering deeper in the gyre.
What should we do? I mean, the pillar said we should find our own soul. What would that help? It would help us find Aethys somehow, or disconnect us from Aethys. When we reach out to the lost souls, that might be risky. Also, we are in a place, it could as well be a dream world. How could we help the lost souls? Harsh decision. Aethys, stop. I think he would not listen, and also we don't take God seriously. So we can't really, yeah, I mean, we could talk to them, but his strange and hypnotic marching is, or rather suggests he's maybe hypnotized. He's himself pulled there by that giant Audra pillar. So what do? I think we'll push past the lost souls to find our own soul and disconnect it from that god, so we can better help the others then.
You attempt to evade the lost souls and find yourself within Aethys. But the incredible power flowing through the gods' body repulses you. Not even your Watcher powers can penetrate the massive tides of energy crashing through him. The souls sense your presence and continue to desperately cry out to you. Aethys' stride slows and stops. His head slowly pivots until its great burning eyes are cast back along the cord. As his gaze meets yours, you feel an overwhelming rush of incredible joy mingled with profound sadness. You have sensed similar anguish in lost souls, but never with this intensity. A soothing voice drifts into your mind.
He's trying to do something to us.
It takes great bravery to venture through the in-between, even for a Watcher.
A swell of admiration radiates out from the god's heart, a force so intense that it momentarily overwhelms you.
You do not need to follow me, for their sake or your own. Something beautiful is coming. Something that will save us all.
A great light shines from Aethys's brow. So bright that even the souls within him flinch from the source, cowering in fear. Through the glare, you see Aethys' massive arm reach up to grasp the golden cord. The tether, carrying energy from the Audra pillar to him, that also suspends your consciousness.
Is that a dream? It is probably some kind of dream. Maybe we have contact, and he spoke to us. Hey man, I mean, what would we say? Not respecting authority, not respecting his words as a god, just as some kind of spoiled child that we see gods often. Give me my soul back. Don't give us that soothing stuff.
I still have need of it, but do not be afraid, Watcher. Dawn will come for us all in time.
Aethys yanks on the golden cord, pulling it from his back. The cord tears into filaments that blacken and dissolve to dust. Without pause, he turns to resume his stride toward the distant pillar of Audra, shining on the boundless horizon. You hear the souls within him cry out for just a moment, before your consciousness is snapped away from them. The in-between goes dark. For a second, you feel a mix of nausea and a sensation like spinning and falling. Then the moment ends. Your consciousness has returned to the Angwithin arena. The world is sideways, the Audra pillar upside down. You flinch at the feeling that you're standing on the ceiling. The disorientation overwhelms you and you collapse to your knees next to the luminous Audra pillar. Previously dim and flickering, the pillar now glows with a strong and steady light. You touch the Audra again. But the chill and prickling sensations you felt before are gone, replaced with a comforting warmth, like the embers of a fire that has just lost its flame.
As you return to the world, you feel a hand on your back. What hand is it? Take your bets. We're going to make a pause here, and thank you for watching. And happy gaming to you. See each other in the next episode. Have a good time until next time. Which hand is it?